So one of the things that you had mentioned earlier, you talked about leverage buyouts, also referred to as LBOs. I'd love to have you expand on what that is to give our audience a better understanding of that specific niche, because this is a very interesting play. And you had said it before, one of the things you love to do is no cash down deals. And I'd love to dial in, to some more of the details there, but often these LBOs are a no cash deal or a low cash deal. And I'd love to have you share some of your experiences there and what that specifically is.
Sure. So really, that's just one of a whole bunch of strategies, and there's over 200 of those that we've been able to identify over the years to acquire a company without having to come out of pocket for it. And so my first exposure to it was back in the days when KKR was doing its acquisitions, and then there's this giant deal with America Online that got acquired, and it was all this debt. And so that's really just taking a look at what are the assets that exist in a business and saying, is there the ability to leverage these assets to generate enough debt to acquire the company? That's really what that's about, right? I'm going to buy out the company and I'm going to do it using leverage, which is another word for debt. And I'm going to use leverage on the assets that already exist in the company that have capacity to help me borrow enough to generate the acquisition price. And so that was like a very eye-opening thing. It's like you're literally using, and so it's not like a super earth-shaking, creative, off-the-wall, uber niche strategy. It was in the 80s mainstream. It was kind of the thing that they were using in the investment banking world to do these deals. And it's still super popular, and it kind of comes and goes in popularity, and they might slap a different name on it or something like that. But using debt to acquire companies is really, really a great strategy. And so now we've got debt is extremely cheap still, compared to what it has cost historically. And so right now, like, think about how expensive it is if you're going to raise money to buy a company or even raise money to fund your company. Like, you need money. Most people, the culture is, well, let me do a raise, let me do a round, or a startup is saying, let me go and find investors. But if you can create the same capital or the same cash that you need to do whatever it is that you're going to do with that investment through debt, as opposed to having equity people come in, it's so much less expensive. Equity is the most expensive form of capital you'll ever generate. So debt can be repaid from the profits, and then it's gone. Shareholders are forever, right? Until you buy them out. So I think that's a really, really great strategy, but it's just one. And so, like, thinking more mainstream for a lot of the people that might be listening is, like, really super, super simple for acquisition is seller financing, also a form of debt, and also could be argued that is a leverage buyout, but there's not really the asset that you're leveraging there is the company that you're buying as a whole. So it's generally the equity or the assets of the company that you're buying, then serve as the collateral for the loan that the selling shareholder or owner is going to give to you to finance the acquisition of the business. And what I'll typically do, kind of like my opening round when I'm talking to a seller, is let's do 80% as seller financing and 20% as an earnout. So that, assuming that the company continues to do what we all think it's going to do for the next couple of years, then I'll pay you that last 20%. But that's my hedge and my ability to see, do you have faith that the company is going to do that for the next couple of years? So you'll only get that 20% if the company does that well. The other 80%, I'd like you to finance over 8 or 10 years. And that's my opener. And sometimes it's like, okay. And sometimes it's like, oh, heck no. I want 100% cash. But then it's like, okay, now we're negotiating, right?
That's right. Yeah, and it's great just to start somewhere. I feel like if you're going to start somewhere, start with the most ideal scenario for you, and then move from there as you need. Because at the end of the day, the goal of a negotiation is to figure out what the other person wants. And often what the other person wants is different than what you want. So very likely you can structure a deal that's super advantageous for you because they want a different outcome in that transaction.
Yeah, and I think that's a great place to talk about the law of price and terms, right? So I don't generally negotiate that much on the price if I'm acquiring, because the seller has a price that they want to get. And so I'm like, okay, look, if I can get you the price that you want, then the law of price and terms is your price, my terms, right? If you want your price and your terms, that's just not fair. You want your price plus all cash. You know, if you want all cash, then it's going to be my price, which is going to be a lot lower. But I'd love to work with you and collaborate. And I use collaborate instead of negotiate with when I'm talking to people. It's like, you know, hey, let's collaborate because I'm really here to get you that thing you want, which is your price. And as you pointed out, they want the price. So then it's like, okay, well, I want my terms and you want the price. Those are not mutually exclusive. What's really cool about that is we can both get what we want out of this. So let's see how we can collaborate on the terms part to figure out what terms will also satisfy what you expect to do with the money after you close. Because a lot of people don't know. A lot of people are going to take the money and do something with it that's going to return a lot less than I'd be willing to return. So it's like, well, why don't you just invest in me and your company that you already have, that you know all of the skeletons in the closet for, and get maybe 6% on your money instead of 2%, you know? So what if I can give you three times what you're going to get by sticking the money in the bank or in some super safe investment that you're thinking about retiring on? And by the way, if I don't perform, you can have the whole company back and sell it again, right? That's kind of a good, sexy, let's all get what we want out of it, I think, way to approach it.